ELSITA, you've been through many different ways of trying to keep yourself healthy. And some of the things that I love to hear you recite are your poems about food.
And staying healthy.
A few of your little doctor poems. ELSITA makes up these wonderful little poems for the people who help to assist her to stay the radiant being that she is.
Well, I lived quite a different life. I was a wonderful cook. I was a gourmet French cookbook. Everything I did with, I mean, hollandaise sauce made with yolks of egg and heavy cream. And
I remember those days.
Oh, weren't they wonderful? And then I went to a doctor for a checkup for the first time in a long time, and he found that my cholesterol was 400 plus, which is apparently fantastic.
I didn't know anybody got that high.
No, but people, no. So he put me on a strict diet, and then he said, no eggs. So for a short while, I had no eggs. And then I went to a chiropractor, and he said, that's nonsense. He said, the white, if you eat the white too, then it counteracts whatever it is that's bad, the cholesterol in the yolk. You can have an egg every day, you can have two. Now, I always want what I'm apparently not supposed to have, and so I have an egg every morning, and it just is wonderful. So then I came out to stay with Lili and my daughter, and she is a very modern thing, way of living, lots of vegetables and
No sauces, huh? No hollandaise.
No, none of that lovely thing. And when he said the white contracts the yolks, I said, but then I can't have hollandaise sauce. And he said, you can't have everything. But then I'm trying to remember what some of those funny poems were.
Well, I remember there was one that had in it, but don't tell Lili.
Oh, yes. Let me see.
There was somebody called Barbara.
I don't know if it's a person or a company.
Barbara
puts all these things,
right.
And she said, and I said, if it's sweet, she makes it sour. If it's tender, she makes it tough. And then I can't remember the other one. I was saying, well, this is what I'm eating, but don't tell Lili. and then I had another doctor, the darling little Dr. Couch.
Dr. Couch.
And he gave me but he wanted me only for a week to go on a very strict diet.
Oh, I remember when you wrote that poem. That was really cute.
He said, dear man, I love him. I remember that. We're good friends. But I said, Dr. Couch is no grouch. He'll always you beguile. He'll take away your favorite food, but always with a smile. And then I said, breakfast blues. Can't have no tea, can't have no egg, can't have no toast. Guess I'll go back to bed.
I love how you take everything and make it fun.
Yes, even I had polio as a baby, you know.
I know.
And I got over it. And in fact, I remember some very attractive movie actor whom I was thrilled about asked me. He said I asked to be introduced to the girl with the beautiful walk. I was a charity thing, and I was holding and broke. So I not only learned to walk as well as everybody else, but I walked better.
Well, you really worked
now
at
I'm,
it, didn't
I,
you?
Yes, I did.
Yes, I know. You have a very determined mind. I know that about you.
I get
you.
What I want.
And
if I decide that's really what I'm going to get, and I do.
And you go for
nothing,
it.
Nothing gives me, I'm very stubborn.
Yeah, well, you go for it. It's important.
Yeah.
You know, I think that
so
kind
then
of
I started,
stubbornness
since
helps.
I got to Maui, not it would have happened anywhere else. This leg started to get weak and wobbly, and I thought, what is the matter? After having worked so hard, and then I went to the doctor, and he said I had post-polio syndrome. And he said, many, many people have it, and you're lucky it's not worse. Some of them end up in wheelchairs.
That mean the polio comes back? What does that mean?
I don't quite understand those things. It's like Lili has hepatitis C, which she got when she was 13 years old from the only blood transfusion she's ever had. So apparently every 30 years with the polio, it can c- come back.
Reactivate.
Reactivate. Mm-hmm. Yeah, isn't that amazing?
That is amazing.
So when you said I make fun of it, I do.
I do, so and I said, love the way you
the
do.
The doc said post-polio syndrome, because now I'm wearing a cane. But I beat that bastard long ago, and I will beat it again. And we'll have a jolly party to celebrate that great game called the post-post-polio party as I swish it down the drain.
I just love, I love your, I'm trying to think of the French words.
Joie de vivre.
Yes.
Joie de vivre.
Joie de vivre.
Yes, right. The joy of life.
The joy of life.
Yes.
And you represent that so well to me. And that's the main reason that I wanted you to be on here today, because I know all these people out here that are sitting home in their living rooms watching television. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but that they need to see how incredible you are and how you can get out and do things. I mean, your social calendar is more active than mine. I mean, I was supposed to have lunch with Elsita the other day, and I was so thrilled I was going to have her all to myself. And then two of my friends heard that I was having lunch with Elsita, and they said, I want to have lunch with Elsita too.
I know I am so lucky. Lucky to have such wonderful friends, and lucky that I'm never lonely, never bored. Never.
But
never.
It's because of who you are, because you're so alive and so inspiring.
Oh, that's wonderful to have you say that.
Well, it's the truth. And I know that the last time we did a show, that many people in our audience sent videos of you. Did you know that? They sent videos of you to their mothers and fathers.
Oh, no,
and
I didn't know
that.
People
on the mainland. Yes, they did.
Oh, I remember I said to you, I must find that video so I can see, look at it and find out all the things I did then which I shouldn't do again. And I couldn't find it.
Right.
And I said, I'm going to be, well, I had a lot of new stuff to say, yeah. But some of my poetry is going to be very repetitive. And you said, well, it doesn't matter.
Exactly.
People like your poetry and they'd like to hear it again, so you don't have to worry about that.
I hear Elsita's poems over and over again because you share them with me many times.
The new ones and that I'm writing,
I
yeah.
always love to hear them, whether yeah. it's the new ones or the old ones.
Yeah.
I love to hear them. You know, I don't think that you would ever bore anybody by repeating
yeah.
a poem. Because they're so beautiful.
Oh, well, that's lovely.
Mm-hmm.
That's lovely.
So do you think that it's your poetry that, what do you think keeps you so alive?
The joie de vivre. You can't say it better than that. The joy of being alive. But at the same time, it's wonderful. Oh, I'll tell you another thing that keeps me feeling good, because I can't lose. If I stay here, I'm having a good time. If I leave, I'll be with Duncan. I can't lose.
Jason, don't you want to come in here and join us for a little bit?
Okay.
Come on, Jason.
I have a question. Why don't you move over just a little bit? Stay where you are.
Pretty dress.
Thank you.
Here's my question. Hi, Elsita.
Hi.
You know, you talk about spirituality and being in touch with Duncan and the afterlife mm-hmm. and the angel of death.
Mm.
When did you first begin to be aware of it? Were you afraid of it? Did it suddenly
never.
Sort of open to
never,
you?
Never, 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 never. Can I think about this for a moment?
Sure.
Because,
you know, in our lives...
I think the first time was that I was conscious of Ivy was when Ivy said, now that you've come out of this sickness so well, you could have died. I think it would be nice if you wrote a poem. And that was the first time I was aware of it. And... Oh, I did have a strange feeling. Natalie was Duncan's wife, and we were good friends for a good many years.
Before you? Not at the same time.
this was performed.
His first wife.
And this was so extraordinary. Am I on? Should I face out?
Whatever feels good.
Yeah, yeah. Doug and I had to go. This was after Doug and I had been married. Oh, I don't know how long. I really don't know how much about time. I was watching Walter Cronkite on the TV. And that was the first time I was conscious, really, of that voice. I think because as I was listening to the news, I suddenly heard Duncan had found a box of garnet, small stones but beautifully designed. There was a necklace and earrings and a bracelet. And he did what he always did. He said, "Would you like them?" And I said what I always said, "No, give them to your granddaughter." And so this voice said, "Go and get that box of garnets and hold them in your hands." And what do you think I said? I said, "I'm busy, I'm looking at the news." And then I thought, hey, that was strange. If you heard a voice that said that, that's weird. You better go and find out what it's all about.
Go hold those garnets.
Yes. So I went and I got them. And they'd been lying for a year or so in a drawer. And they looked dingy. So I didn't think at all. I just did what it seemed to me the thing to do. I went and I held them under the kitchen sink and poured the water, poured some soap on them, scrubbed them. And then I rinsed them and dried them in a towel. And they were glowing and beautiful. And suddenly, Natalie was there standing beside me. And she was enormously fat. She weighed 250 pounds. But she was slim and beautiful. And I'd been told she was very beautiful when she was there. And she just came and said, I wanted to come and have a good laugh with you. And so we both laughed together, and then she vanished.
Oh, wow.
And wasn't that strange? And I thought it was so sweet that she came to say that she was happy, that all was well, and to just give her friendship and her blessing to Duncan and me, and say everything was fine. So,
that's wonderful.
No, I always am wondering, you know, when people suddenly embrace spirituality and an awareness of another world, in this new age that we're in.
Oh, absolutely.
Like you said, you would never mention some of these things if you were sitting back in New York. They'll think you're losing it.
Right.
But you've come to really understand that the way our society has looked at life and death may not be actual, that you've really experienced that bridge.
Yeah.
And so that's what I was really trying to see.
Yes.
Was it something you did or it just happened? Just happened.
I guess it happened when I was ready for it. I guess. I was going to say it happened when I had the pain of Duncan having the stroke, but it didn't. It happened when I wrote the first little book of Songs of Thanksgiving.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, you're lucky to be alive. And then I started thinking, yeah, you could be dead. Aren't you glad you're alive? You better write a poem. And ever since then, it's been flowing.
That's
when I first heard that little voice. Why don't you write poetry?
Do you know that on the first show that we have, which is still on the air, Mama Presents, that in the opening credits, atop of the logo, there's me, and then down below is you and Arielle.
Oh,
on every opening show that we do.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, really? How nice.
Uh-huh.
How nice. How nice.
Yeah.
You are a welcome guest on that show, and I know here in Arielle's world, what would Arielle's world be without you?
Well, I think that's absolutely wonderful.
That's right, Elsita. You are tremendous inspiration to me.
Hmm. Well, people tell me that you're a role model, you're an inspiration on account of what age I am, that I don't feel that I'm that age at all. And so I said, oh, well, then I better behave. And then they said, no, stay the way you are.
We don't want you to behave. That's why you're an inspiration.
Oh, good, because sometimes I think I'm too outrageous.
You are outrageous. That's why you're an inspiration.
Mm.
I know that you were brought up, knowing you, I know that you were brought up with a very strict young life, and you were brought up with certain rules and how things to be and were not to be. Did and I am sure one of those rules was not seeing people sitting on the roof. ELSITA told me a story which I like very much. I hope you don't mind my sharing it. Maybe you'll tell it to the people.
I don't know what room
I'm getting there. It was about the story that you told me when first kissing a boy, and that your mother told you that when you decided that you were going to marry this young man.
Yes, she said to me, when I was in my teens, I don't know just at what age, and I was reading romantic novels, all these beautiful things, and seeing movies, and so I asked her about it, and I said, about this kissing, tell me, and she said, well, I'll explain to you. She said, when among your suitors you decide which one you want to marry, and he proposes and you accept him, that is when you have your first kiss.
Did you hear that? After you accept his proposal, you may have your first kiss.
That's right. And then when I was 22 and I had a very sophisticated older friend, she was 4 years older than I am, but she was very sophisticated. And she'd been engaged 12 times. And I suppose that was because you're not supposed to kiss unless you're engaged. Don't you? I don't know.
12 times.
But then she said to me, sweet 16, never been kissed as charming. Sweet 22, never been kissed as ridiculous.
So what'd you do about that?
Well, I decided to try it. And then my family didn't think too much of this young man. They thought I should, he was a very nice young man, but nothing special.
And not special enough for you.
Yeah, I don't know what they wanted for me. They wanted some marvelous person.
They wanted Prince.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course they did.
Yeah.
You deserve a Prince.
So then my stepfather said you were only allowed to see him once every 2 weeks. Well, that wasn't good enough, so I went out and I said, do you still want to marry me? And he said, yes. He was surprised, and there was some time. And then I said, we kissed, and I said, are we engaged? And he said, I guess so. And I went home and told my family, and they kept saying, you can still change your mind. But that's one thing that is such a severe bringing up is not. He was a lovely man, but Duncan was the great love of my life. I didn't really know what it was. So
it's really been so wonderful of you to take your time this morning.
Oh, our time is a thing that I have plenty of, fortunately.
Well, I don't know about that, ELSITA. You're a pretty busy lady.
Well, yes, I do seem to be, but I'm just so lucky to be here in Maui, and I want to tell all my friends that might look on this how much I appreciate their friendship and their love, and how much they have made in healing me after my loss, and that how I feel great now, and it's their love and their sweetness that has helped me, and I want to wish you wonderful luck on your new venture here, and may it just roll and roll and get better and better as time goes on.
Thank you. Well, what I would like to know, I'm going to give you two questions. If you could tell the people in our audience one thing about life that you think would help them, what would you say?
Well, I can answer that pretty easily because I'd always been very close to my mother and hadn't been on my own at all. And when I found myself married and on my own and could do anything I liked, I started thinking about things for the first time. And I said to myself, now, what is the most important thing in life? And then it came up with a sense of values. Find out what's important and don't let the rest bother. And I've always gone on that. But then years later, I again asked myself, what is the most important thing in life? And it was love. But they weren't contradicting themselves. You find out what is the most important thing and you go for it. No, I think for most people it would be love, don't you? But for other people it isn't, and they're not the fortunate ones. So that a sense of value, so you know what's right, and that's part of the same circle, and what is important, and go for it. And love is a great go for it, yeah.
Go for it is the key word there, I think.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, darling.
And
thank Jason.
I have another question. All the people that are out here that are in pain or mourning for whether it be their spouse or their child or their parent, what word of advice would you give them for that?
Oh gosh, that's hard for me to say because I have a rule that I don't give people advice because I don't think I'm wise enough. But I do try if they tell me about what situation that they are, to try and with them to clarify it, and to try and understand it, and consider it from different points of view, and then they must know what's the right one for them. All I can do is I never give advice.
Well, that's good advice.
But my inner self says to me very often, well, if I were you, I would do this. And I said, what do you mean if you were me? You are me. That's so ridiculous. But she says, well, if I were you, I'd do this. Ivy says, that's ridiculous, isn't it?
No, she's just, she knows that if she tells you to do something, you wouldn't do it. So she has to say, if I were you, I would do this.
That's funny, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it's also the truth, right?
Yeah.
Because you're very strong-willed and strong-minded.
Yes, and stubborn. I'm very sure.
Well, I think that's part of how you get to be who you are, which is so wonderful.
Yeah, we're good.
And thank you. And, you know, we all look forward to your book coming out. So.
Oh, yes. I must really get going at it. I tell you what has been holding me up is what my Duncan would call funny business. Anything spiritual or weird like that. Oh, he'd say, I don't want to hear that funny business. He knows better now.
He's in the funny business.
Yeah, he's in the funny business. Uh-huh. So that's what's holding me up was my timidity. But I think having said a lot of these things in public today, now that I think of it, this is an important day for me because it will say you can say those things about the Garnets and Natalie and about the other things.
Yes.
About the greatest day of my life was when Duncan was already gone and I flew to meet him. And because now I know that it's true. And that's very different from just believing.
It is.
I know it because I've been there.
Well, yeah. I love that you were there, and I love that you're here to tell us that you were there.
Yes. Yeah. Thank you. That was very well put.
And thank you very much. And we are we've been talking for such a long time that this show is probably going to end up in two different shows. So that'll be fun.
Yes.
Yeah.
I kept thinking it's getting awfully long.
Well, it's like when you said to me, what am I going to say? And I said, don't worry, Elsita. Just you and I talking. Well, we always have plenty to say.
Yes, that's right, because you handled it so beautifully. And the trouble isn't getting me to talk. I'm afraid it's getting me to shut up.
I love you. Thank you so much for joining us here today.
And thank you, Jason, and thank you, Ariel. I feel that it's a day that has really set me going along even better on the path that I'm going.
I'm so glad for that. And I'm glad that whatever you might have gotten to put out here, whatever doors that opens for you, I know we will all be blessed by those doors opening for you.
Yes, so I must get to work and not so much play and get at that book.
Oh, playing is good too, though.
Oh, yes.
It's still important. So we really thank you very, very much, and I hope you enjoyed today's show. I'm sure that ELSITA, if you wanted to contact her, you could contact her through Maui Arts and Music Association. We'll put that number on the board for you. And or send her a letter. I know she would love to hear from you, and I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful day or evening, and you will tune in again to see what's next.
What's next on your exciting show?
That's right.
Yeah, I know it's going to be very exciting, and I'm honored to have been the opener.
I'm honored that you're here. Aloha.
Aloha.
Letting us be on Akaku, Maui Community Television. Oh, yeah. Akaku. Let's give Lono a hand. The man. Our videographer, Airielle. Airielle. That's right. We're going to have to bring two microphones next time. Let's see. We're just going to do this. Lono lets me do this just for fun. So let's see what comes out. Oh, I know this one. Sitting in the morning sun. Well, I'll be sitting till the evening comes. Watching the ships rolling.
Out of the sun under the border, we'll be having some fun under the border. Jonathan. Who's the Jonathan?
Brett.
Okay, Brett. Happy birthday, Brett. We'll change it. Now, John, change that to Brett. Brett. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday. And Jason, happy birthday to you too, Jason.
Yeah.
Lono. Thank you, Sports Page. Thank you guys for being a wonderful audience.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Aloha. Thanks, Lono.
Thanks, Jason.
Good evening.
Let me in. Hello there. Vote now.
Close.
Hungry. Please vote no.
They were Bessie and Don at the beginning without a last name.
Hello. We're Sue and Harry. Yes. Dude, I don't know you actually.
But I said you could come to the party.
Yes, you did.
Right.
You came to Ken.
Oh, that's right. Okay.
Harry, hello, hello. Thank you so much.
You're German, right? Austrian.
No, I'm in Austrian.
You're what?
Austria.
Austria. We can who strike the vote?
Oh, good.
The 19th Bezirk and Dean
strike. Oh, in Dean in 19th
Bezirk. I don't know how you are.
Really?
Stimmt.
Yeah.
Yeah, sehr schön. Aber kein Sonne.
Sonne.
Sonne. Do my little door thing. You're gonna be up for booby prize. Oh, she's gonna be up for booby prize. Oh, this is a good one.
No moaning.
Do you do?
There's been a couple come close to it.
Yeah, but we dragged them up.
I love you.
children in there?
Uh-huh.
No little children. Picture of the that's a Freud and enjoy him. And there he is, the star of our enjoy. It's from.
Oh, I'm tempted.
She came upon another traveler who was very hungry. And she opened her bag to share her food with the traveler. When he saw the stone in the bag, he admired it, realizing the value of this stone. And he asked the woman if he could have it. She gave it to him without hesitation. Rejoicing in his good fortune, because he knew that that stone was worth enough money that he would never have to work another day in his life. But a few days passed, and he came back to the mountain searching for the woman. And when he found her, He gave her back the stone. And he said, I give you back this stone. I've been thinking. I know how very, very precious this is. But I give it back to you in hopes that you can give me something far more valuable. If you can you give to me what you have within you that enabled you to give me the stone?